Joining us is Kevin Bartini. He's got two albums that everybody should go purchase, Showing the Horses Who's Boss and the Unintentionally White album. Go buy them wherever fine comedy CDs are purchased. How are you, sir?
Oh, my goodness. David, I'm very frustrated, and I'm very sad about the news that is just broken here.
Oh, what happened?
Well, David, I mean, first of all, we all know that the Amazon is on fire right now, and global warming is getting exponentially worse. And knowing that I have a future of nothing but dog days of summer ahead of me, the one solace I had to hang on to was the fact that I could always get affordably priced ball powder. But the cost of ball powder is about to go through the roof because the people who make the ball powder, Johnson & Johnson's, now apparently have gotten everybody in Oklahoma hooked on opioids and have to pay $572 million to the state of Oklahoma. That is
unfair to
you. It's so unfair to me, David. To Oklahoma. By the way, Oklahoma, $572 million is more money than anyone in Oklahoma could spell.
And they're saying that Johnson & Johnson caused the opiate addiction in Oklahoma.
The ball powder.
I think living in Oklahoma causes the opiate addiction.
I don't know. I'm just really...
Let me ask you a question.
Last bit of bad news, that I could handle today.
So they're going to pass the cost on to you, the consumer.
Exactly.
Because you use their ball powder.
Exactly.
And you're going to have itchy balls.
Yes. I'm going to have swampy, itchy balls for the rest of my life in this global warming climate that we have. Like, now it's like I'm suffering. Like, I'm the one who got all of Oklahoma hooked on opioids. I didn't. This is not fair, David, as a consumer, that this is going to be hitting me right in the coin purse. And by that, I mean my ball bag.
You're just a tax-paying American with sweaty balls.
Yes, that's right. I'm a tax-paying American with sweat. And aren't we all at the end of the day?
Now, they call it baby powder. And here is the thing I've always wondered about. How sweaty does a baby's balls get? That there's an entire industry built around ball powder for babies.
Well, I mean, think of it this way. A baby did just spend 9 months soaking in amniotic fluid. So that's gotta... I've never seen amniotic fluid, but I'm guessing there's a little residual, a little bit, kind of that feeling at the end of the day when the sunscreen feels kind of... I don't know. I don't remember.
So you put baby powder on your balls...
I'm not going to go on the national podcast here of David Feldman and say that I do. What I'm saying is possibly I'm just feeling empathy for folks who do. I'm not going to admit to it. I have a big heart, David, is what it is, and I feel for others.
Now, where do they grind these babies up to make the powder? I've always wondered about that.
I don't know. And you know what? Now that you mention it, that bothers me because if I don't want to get stuck paying top dollar for Johnson & Johnson's ball powder for the rest of my life, I'm going to have to figure out the recipe to make it myself. I don't want to grind any babies, David. I don't want to do it.
And you don't want to go cheap when it comes
to
powdering.
No, you don't want to go cheap grinding kittens. Fuck that.
You want the real thing.
I want the real thing.
You will spare no expense for your balls, right?
I thought so. That's right. I like to powder the baby maker. That's all I can say, David. Why it's called that, I think.
Well, I'm sure Johnson & Johnson will appeal the ruling, which will make it even more expensive.
Sure, because, they're going to have even more legal fees. I mean, what are they doing getting into this anyway? These guys got into business together for one reason, to make ball powder. Because because they were like, hey, we both have the same last name. And hey, it means dick. Let's get together.
So Johnson & Johnson, they make rubbers?
It was preordained. What's that?
They make rubbers?
No, just do they make, it's everything about the dick. It's the powder, And I don't know if they make rubbers, but probably at this point they're making everything else.
Why do they call your dick the Johnson? Specifically
Mine?
Yours. Yes.
the Johnson.
Because it killed Kennedy. Other than that. When did they start calling a penis a Johnson?
I don't know. Somebody should write actually a good book on the history of every, you know, the slang and kind of stuff. That would be interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
But I don't know. Just so much bad news going on in the world. Did you hear about the story out of France?
Well, before you get to the stories, I have a story for
okay.
you. Because it's the doldrums of summer.
Yeah.
And, you know, most people take August off. We don't.
Right.
We keep going. We don't know
That's
how
right.
to stop. And Joe Biden.
Us, we plug on. And you know who else does? The fellas in the factory that manufacture ball powder.
Yes,
this is their
do.
Busy season. It's their busy season, Dave.
Yeah.
And I salute them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anyway, back to your story about the doldrums.
Yeah. Joe Biden out there at the age of 95 campaigning for president. And a lot of people think he may be senile. Or depressed.
Yes.
I think he's depressed. I think he's had some bad news in his life.
Oh, and, sure has.
And he just wants to stay in the arena, you know, for the adrenaline. But here he is. We have a clip of Joe Biden up in Keene.
I mean, Joe Biden, but he has had a lot of tragedies in his life. Like, he is the human embodiment of Rose Kennedy's black dress.
You're saying that Rose Kennedy always had a black dress ready.
Yeah. At the go. Yeah.
At the go. Yeah.
She kept it next to her car keys.
And a pole. She used to just go down the pole and hop into the hearse. And she was ready at a moment's notice.
The hearse always had the lights on, ready to go.
Uh-huh.
Anyway.
So Joe was in.
About Joe Biden.
there's a big, big, big election coming up in 2020. And mm-hmm. Joe Biden was in Keene, New Hampshire, talking mm-hmm. to the local press, and they asked him what he thought of being in Keene, New Hampshire. Let's take a listen.
Mission of Keene.
I've been here a number of times. Last time was, I think, all the way back in 2014, but I've been here before that. I love this place. Look, what's not to like about Vermont in terms of the beauty of it, and what a neat town.
Yeah. What's not to like about Vermont
right.
and the beauty of it? So he thought he was in Vermont.
Well, he was in Keene, New Hampshire, so in fairness to him, maybe he could see Vermont from there. So he would technically not be wrong as he's looking out uh-huh. past Keene. Yeah, I think ball dropped there because you would expect a softball like that to be tossed to 800-year-old Joe Biden. How do you feel about being here in the town of Keene? That he would have... You know he still thinks that the word keen is used by kids, right? He dropped a moment to, well, I think it's neato and keen. Peachy keen. That's what he should have said. I think it's peachy keen. Instead, he tries to impress us by telling us he knows what state he's in. Ball dropped.
Now, you're a stand-up comic, right?
Yes. Yes, from time to time.
Think the cardinal sin... Mm-hmm. of opening your show by saying it's great to be back in Vermont when you're playing New Hampshire. They'll run you out of town if you
run you out of town if you're playing Vermont because they'll know you're lying.
Right.
Yeah. No, you shouldn't. You just. I'm from the Northeast, though. I'm from, you know, Western Massachusetts, which, you know, I've been up to Vermont. I've been to New Hampshire many, many times throughout my life. They are quite interchangeable. So I don't, you know, I kind of feel like I want to give him a pass on this because you're, you know, he's just getting on a bus. They're taking him somewhere. They're, you know, giving the same speech. There's such a Groundhog Day effect to it that I do give him a little bit of a pass. But
he's not too sharp, is he?
Not too sharp.
And
he's not.
You know, he got the cities of the shootings wrong. He mm-hmm. got Dayton and El Paso wrong after the shootings.
Right.
And I guess he gave an interview where he made a statement that he's not crazy. People have been questioning his sanity. Did you see that?
Oh, yeah. You know where he gave that interview?
Where?
In the irony capital of the moment, in front of a place called Loon Lake.
He said, I'm not crazy.
He said, I'm not crazy at Loon Lake.
Wow.
And which is weird because the question was, how do you like being here at Loon Lake? And he just said, I'm not crazy. He could have said, I'm loony for it. They really ought to hire me on one of these campaigns because I would be a big help right there.
Yeah. And later that day, he said, I had no work done. And it was in front of Facelift Lake, actually. And then he said, this is really my hair at Plugs Mountain Resort. At Plugs, yeah. Okay. All right. So, what's going on? You've been reading?
I've been reading. I've been reading because it's a good way to, you know, sometimes take a break from the news and from all the bad news. So I've been doing some reading and some writing, a little arithmetic, you know. But I don't know, David. There's so much sadness in the world. I wanted to tell you about this thing. You must have heard of it because you're on Twitter and such. But you heard about the tragic auto accident that happened in France this past weekend.
Well, I know it didn't involve ball powder. I don't think they don't use ball powder, do they?
They don't use ball. No, they do not use ball powder, so it doesn't affect ball powder. But no, this is terrible. It was a tractor trailer that had left a factory farm, was carrying over 200 pigs to be slaughtered, and it went. Took a turn too sharp, and sounds like it kind of went over a bit of a cliff there and crashed, and tragically 182 pigs died in the crash, which is, as an animal lover, you know, it makes me so sad. 182 pigs died this weekend, and it's 183 if you count David Koch.
That's right, David Koch. Died last week.
Yeah,
he was in vacationing in France.
I wish that he died that he had just been taking a scenic walk at that moment and had been trounced by 200 pigs. 182 of them died. Only according to this article, only 23 pigs survived, and I'm told that they were delicious.
Well, that is tragic.
It is tragic. Yeah. It is. You
don't
know,
they have seat belts for the pigs?
No, that's only when they're in their pens to keep them from moving, but not when they're being transported for their safety. No, they don't.
I see.
But you know, they were headed to the irony, of course, is they were headed to the slaughterhouse anyway. But that doesn't stop the online community. It's quite crestfallen. There's been an outpouring of tweets remembering the pigs and frowny face emoticons. And then also zero tweets or frowny face emoticons for the other 300,000 pigs slaughtered that day.
Yes, in France.
And no, over the world. 300,000 a day is what I found in research. You know, that
and
is,
do you, and do you eat
it's
ham?
A tragic day. It's a tragic day that will be remembered in the factory farming community as Saturday.
That is bizarre that we care how the pig dies. Do you eat them afterwards? I mean, does it matter how the pig dies?
That's a question. I mean, that is your... Are you technically now eating roadkill?
Trump economy another year and we'll all be eating roadkill.
Well, of course. Yeah. We'll be fighting each other over the last squirrel. But this is... I've been thinking about that ever since I read this. Like, yeah, did they just pick the carcasses up? And I imagine they just did and just headed them on in, probably in the same in the same truck with the 23 survivors.
Well, I haven't been reading the news, so tell me what's going on with Trump. I understand he met with world leaders. Bolsonaro called Macron's wife a pig, right?
Uh huh.
And
Well, he's at the G7, and he is. Well, I guess I think it's over now. He's probably flying home, proving that pigs can fly.
Did you see the picture of Melania kissing Justin Trudeau?
Holy shit, was she hungry? Look at that picture.
Yeah.
That, yeah. Oh my God. That is. Could you ever, as beautiful a woman as she is, ever have sex with her knowing that, you know, she had been with Donald Trump for years and years? I think that, well, to me, the idea of having sex with her would be like building my home on like a old graveyard or something. It's a lovely view, but it's going to creep the fuck out of me. And, you know, I'll end up throwing myself down a flight of stairs in the middle of the night somehow. Not going to go good. But yeah, I saw that picture. That was, I think, I'm hoping people tweet that at the president just constantly.
She hates him. I mean, that's just like a subtle dig.
Oh, yeah.
That any spouse who hates her husband would do something like that.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
And so good. I enjoyed that moment. But the big story this week out of everything is a story that has come out that Donald Trump, I guess a couple of months ago or at least twice during his administration in meetings with the National Security Agency, he has brought up the idea about, you know, hurricane preparedness, not about, you know, actually building levees or getting food supply stock. He had the idea, what if we were to hit the hurricane with a nuclear bomb over Africa? And then the rest of the world would be saved.
Did he really say that?
Yes.
Over Africa?
He said, I have the quote. He absolutely said it begins, most of them begin in Africa.
No, they don't. And,
well, let me see. Let's see. Yeah, here's the article. It's an amazing article I read. Yes. Okay. So according to the source who was there, Trump said, they start forming over the coast of Africa, and they're moving across the Atlantic. We drop a bomb inside the eye of the hurricane, and it disrupts it. We can't do that? Why can't we do that, is what he said, the president. Paraphrase the president's remarks.
Don't they start in the doldrums down in the southern hemisphere?
Well, they start wherever – don't they start wherever the warmth, you know, gets warm enough to heat water?
Yeah.
Actually. Water. So yeah, it would start in a hotter climate and in the Caribbean. It starts around here, but I don't think a lot of hurricanes would start in Africa and hit us. Whatever. That's
he blames Africa for everything.
Oh, absolutely.
He thinks hurricanes are caused. He thinks hurricanes were caused by somebody having sex with a monkey.
Yeah. No, it's no joke.
Yeah.
He is. It's, you know, people are wondering, you know, where he even came up with this idea, just the idea of, you know, taking a storm, you know, killing a storm by putting a nuclear bomb in it. Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing from what I know about him, that was actually the plot from his favorite book, Sharknado, the novel. They did that in the novel.
Did they do that in Sharknado?
I can only imagine. How would you stop a tornado of sharks? You got to bomb the shit out of it. I would imagine. I didn't see the movie. I'm waiting for the musical to come to Broadway. Sharknado the musical should be soon.
How can you be that stupid to think that an atomic bomb, a nuclear bomb, would destroy just a hurricane?
Yeah, or not think it through that even if it did disrupt the wind patterns, now it's blowing nuclear radiation at, you know, at a hurricane's pace back across the land and everything else.
Everywhere. You
know, everywhere. This was such a bad idea. Trump's idea of throwing a nuclear bomb into a hurricane to appease the gods, you know, was such a bad idea that this is the first time in their administration that even Mike Pence disagreed with him, stating that it's much better to throw in the Virgin. You know, when prayer doesn't work, you gotta, and you know, you gotta get a virgin.
Wow.
There was another fun quote in here. about the leak who was talking about this said, you know, the how did they react? Well, sir, we'll look into that. Just totally blowing him off. And he kind of got incredulous and talking about how many the hurricanes the U.S. could handle and suggesting that we do this before they make landfall. And then it says that the briefer was quote, knocked on his heels. And then the source in the room added, you could hear a gnat fart in that. It was so quiet that you could hear a gnat fart in that meeting. And this was a couple months ago, and I looked back, and gnat fart was the code name for Sarah Huckabee. Who, while everyone else stood in silent awe, could be heard snacking.
Are you a football fan, speaking of linebackers like Sarah Huckabee?
I am a football fan, and I have, you know, I'm very excited. Actually, right after we record this, I am going to be hosting the draft of my fantasy football league this very evening, David. I'm very excited.
You take this seriously?
Not terribly seriously. I mean, you know, I'm not the type who would, you know, beat his wife if his team loses, but I'm, you know, I take it serious. I'm a fan, sure.
And don't you think football is a little dangerous? Who is this Andy Luck guy?
Andrew Luck, yes. Football is very dangerous.
Is that why you like it?
No. It's much more to it than that. If that was the case, if it was just purely for watching danger or something, then you just watch NASCAR or some shit like that, you know. Mm-hmm. There is strategy.
NASCAR is so dangerous, Dale Earnhardt Jr. got into a plane accident. That's how.
Yeah, he did he recently, right?
Yeah, that's how dangerous NASCAR is.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what happened to his dad?
Yes.
There you go. It's a dangerous ass sport. But no, it's terrible. And Andrew Luck was the quarterback for the Indianapolis Colts. He is 29 years old, was the first round draft pick his rookie year. The Colts. He replaced on the Colts Peyton Manning, who was, you know, this is akin to almost whoever has to replace Tom Brady.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Manning is a legend. And they, you know, the first round, they got this guy. And he's a good quarterback, very good quarterback. But this week, he announced that he is retiring, has had enough, has had enough of the injuries, and is gone. And, you know, I personally feel like good for him. I think this is exactly what the league deserves. You know, you the way they treat players and the concussions and all the injuries, I think the smartest thing to do is get in, get rich, and get out. Like, the league deserves to have no more franchise players that play for 15 years and build the big names that they can really sell and cash in on. You know, Andrew Luck was, probably at some point had a real bright future that they could have really exploited even more. But
how many years could he have played?
The extreme of it is Tom Brady, who is going into his, I believe, 20th season. But the average is far, far lower.
20 seasons. And is he showing any brain damage?
Not so much, except for the hats that he wears to press conferences.
But is he taking hits?
Yeah, of course he takes hits. Absolutely. He's a totally just a different thing. But most guys, you know, 10, 12 years is a thing. But they're finding more and more players are retiring earlier and earlier. And why not? I mean, Andrew Luck, he had a huge, huge $122 million career. And he's leaving like half of that money on the table. But I read one article that said when all is said and done, he has brought himself about $97 million is what he's brought in. Through the NFL, through playing. So the guy doesn't need to work again for the rest of his life. Even a rookie who doesn't make, you know, become a journeyman or play too often, their rookie year, the average is a $500,000. And most guys get signing contracts. You can get yourself a very nice, comfortable start to life without having to, get the brain concussions and the CTEs and
Well, how dangerous are these concussions? What are they finding?
Well, they're finding they're wildly dangerous. These concussions are leading to long-term brain damage, long-term, players dying in their 40s and 50s who have been reduced to, to a puddle. To it's a terrible, terrible thing. But now they're finding even more things. There was a study done recently where they surveyed 2,500 former professional football players, and they have found that concussions are also now linked to erectile dysfunction in former NFL players.
That must make them very pleasant to be around.
One would think.
Yeah.
One would think they would be, the thing is like, well, here's what happened. Here's the study itself. So former professional football players who suffered concussions, it found, or were more likely to develop erectile dysfunction later in life, which is tragic for some players. And for others, well, that's what you get for not covering that spread that one time.
For you specifically.
Yeah, specifically. He knows who he is. But the lead author of the study.
Are you saying that we need to make stronger helmets to protect their helmets?
Stronger helmets to protect their helmets. Maybe some sort of a space age polymer Teflon bulletproof ball powder.
Right. This is so typical of men.
Yeah.
You're reduced to a pool of jelly. You can barely stand. And the one thing you're complaining about is you can't get an erection because you assume still a woman would make love to you.
Right. Well, and this was the interesting part also. Rachel Grashow, the lead author of the paper on this study, neurologist, this is what she said. She said, "We've found a really strong relationship between reports of concussion symptoms and the likelihood that the guys reported erectile dysfunction," right? Because I think that's just because the players who didn't suffer concussions remembered to lie.
So this is the big concern about football. This will actually get more and more men to stop playing football.
I think they
care more about their penis than they do their brain. But you know what it is? Your penis is your brain. So
sure.
And makes sense.
It's interesting that like now, many NFL players, and I do believe Tom Brady is one of them, who said they wouldn't allow their kids to play, peewee football with the pads and everything. Now many, many more towns are having leagues of flag football and, up until high school level, and then they start introducing them to pads and tackle football and stuff. So, and the NFL is now taking, big steps to try to change the game, make it less dangerous. But, to be a fan, you could be a fan of a team and a player, and you just kind of have to divorce yourself mentally from being a fan of the actual NFL, which is such a terrible league.
Yeah.
Bunch of pricks. My takeaway is I'm glad. I think more marquee players should leave early. And I hope, Andrew Luck was on anybody's top, top 10 quarterbacks in the league, probably top five. He makes most links. So I'm hoping that what will happen is he's gone. And if the Colts are smart, I think that they should sign Colin Kaepernick. I'm not fucking lying. I am not lying at all. Somebody needs to. It would be the perfect thing. He's a comparable quarterback.
And he still wants back in, right?
Of course he wants back in. Yeah. And Andrew Luck actually missed the boat too, I think. Because if he, he said it was because of, his injuries, and he's had many, many, many injuries. But what if he was going to retire anyway? So why not just lie and say that, if the league won't play Colin Kaepernick, then he's out too. He could have gone down in history as one of the top, that would have been such a PR coup. Andrew Luck quits league in support of you know?
Yeah.
Fucking chance missed.
Yeah.
But I hope it does. I hope it gets Kaepernick back in the league. Yeah. You know, because he's, you know, a great guy. So,
yeah.
I don't know. But that's about the...
Great. Kevin Bartini has two CDs out, Showing the Horses Who's Boss and the Unintentionally White album. Go to kevinbartini.com for more information on where to catch him. Follow him on Twitter. I believe your Twitter handle is Kevin Bartini?
Sure is, with a little at sign before it.
Fantastic. Stay on the line for 1 second. Thank you, sir. I know how busy you are. It's the end of the summer. Most normal people are outside, but you were willing to come indoors and powder your balls on my show. I appreciate it.
You could hear that?
Yes, I can. I can hear it.